What's up, everybody? Digibro here. I'm looking at Toho, Phantasmagoria of Flower View, the English version. We're gonna play this game. On the easiest possible difficulty. Oh shit, doesn't have all the characters. Oh, god damn it. Usually I play this as Yuka Kazumi, but I guess I'll play as Konpaku Yomu, because she's kind of my girl. She's my icon on my old Sword is Unbelievably Dull site. Hey, it's Cyrano. Oh, man. Whoa, holy shit. Apparently holding shoot just puts me into slow automatically. That's probably too technical for anybody who doesn't know what the fuck's going on. This is a Toho game. You ever heard of Toho? Is this because I'm on easy mode? Is that why I'm automatically in slow? Also, what the hell was that warning? Is that just because of her? Oh, Jesus. Oh my god, I'm like way too drunk and I'm realizing there's a lot of stuff happening on screen right now. Holy shit. Oh my god. So much going on. This is easy mode. Ah! Jesus Christ, fucking icicles. Fuck you, Cyrano. Goddamn. Cyrano and Purple Steve. Okay, I'm remembering the basic concept of this game. Oh, I guess I won? That was awful quick. Holy shit. Whoa, alright. Jesus Christ. Drunker than first realized, I guess. Hoo-wee! Alrighty then. So I was just watching The Blue Glow, which is my good friend Endless Jess's, Let's Play show. Who's pretty drunk on there, and I was a drunk already. I was recording some rap songs for some sick beats made by Shade. He's getting really into music production, man, and he's making some really great stuff. And, you know, I like rapping, so having some really cool beats to rap over has been really inspirational. You know, like, I haven't been rapping much over the last year. I kept blaming the fact that I didn't have enough, like bad stuff going on in my life, because I tend to mostly write lyrics about, like, negative things. So I kept saying, like, stuff was going too well for me to write rap songs. But, of course, that's never really true. I always have angst. I could always write these songs. It's just that I didn't have any, like, good beats. You know, I had to make my own shit, and I've come to terms with the fact that I'm never gonna make music that's, like, accessible to any degree, you know, or something that, like, most people are ever gonna listen to, stuff that I could actually promote. So, like, Shade coming out with these beats that are, like, pretty legit and stuff that I could actually see people enjoying, holy fuck, this is so taxing on my mind to try to keep up with all the things happening on screen. And I'm on, like, the easiest difficulty, I think. I hope this is the easiest difficulty. yeah. It's really inspirational to, like, hear a beat and be like, oh my god, people would listen to this, and if I write a good enough rap to this, people might think this is pretty okay. You know, I wrote a rap song called Waves at he had a song called Waves, and I wrote a rap and called it Waves at Dawn, and I had released it on my SoundCloud. The recording wasn't that great, but then I did a music video, like a live video of it, and like it improved the like tone of the song so much that even Shade really liked it. Like, he hadn't really liked my rap verse that much at first, but then once he heard the like live version, he was like, "Whoa, this is actually really cool." And I was like, "Yeah, make me more beats, and we can like make this a full-time thing we do." So he just made a cool beat, and I rapped over it. And unfortunately, I have to get drunk for me to show any passion, because I'm apparently some kind of robot who can only be analytical and broken when sober. So, my flows, I tend to write raps that have, like, fairly tight flows, like, how do I put it? They're boring. Like, the way I rap is usually very, like, structured and doesn't have a lot of life to it. But when I'm drunk, I can really get into that place of just losing my shit and, like, just going full passion. So, that's what I did on the song. I was like, I didn't expect that to hit me from behind. I guess it's pretty well telegraphed. I just hadn't, like, become aware of the concept of stuff hitting me from behind yet. But yeah, anyway, so I got drunk so I could record this song, and now I'm pretty drunk. And then I watched Jesse's Blue Glow, and I thought, I want to do a Let's Play by myself, because that'll be fun. I haven't done one in a little while, you know, even though I usually think that, like, when we are sort of running low on Digibros episodes is usually when I try to... Ah, shit. Well, okay. I think I have 5 lives in total. I gave myself 5 lives. I set it to the maximum lives in the easiest difficulty because, A, I'm not good at Toho, and B, I'm wasted. So, yeah, I usually do these when we don't have any left, but I don't know. I was wondering if I'd still be in the habit of doing this, because we've talked about how Victor's planning to leave for grad school in, like, June or July. I think it's July that he wants to leave. And, if that happens, then this channel will essentially not be the same, but, like, I've always been thinking that, like, I kind of want to do solo Let's Plays even after Victor's gone, because I think I've gotten, like, decent enough at talking by myself that I could conceivably do them, but, I haven't been that inspired to do that lately, so, I wasn't sure if it would still be a thing, but today I feel pretty inspired, so I figured I might as well. And, you know, if I was regularly doing these alone, then I would probably split them into parts. Like, I tend to write or record very long solo Let's Plays as opposed to, the 20-episode lengths that we stick to when it's me and Victor. With these, I don't usually have episode breaks. I just record as long as I feel like it. So I kind of had a bit to talk about when I was getting ready to record this. I don't know how much of it I'm gonna remember, but the biggest one is that this is fucking Toho, dude. And I wanted to play this because I was watching Jesse's Blue Glow, and he was playing the game Ikaruga, which is a bullet hell game that, like, I knew about in 2003, like, when it came out, because I was a huge GameCube and Nintendo aficionado. And, like, you know, I'd read all these reviews of games and stuff, and Ikaruga got, like, all these rave reviews, and it looked really cool. It had a Japanese-sounding name at a time when I was, like, a super weeaboo. Like, I'd just gotten into anime, and everything from Japan was the coolest fucking thing ever when I was a kid. So, like, you know, I inherently wanted to play Ikaruga. I didn't even really understand what kind of game it was. Like, I'd never heard of bullet hell games before. So, like, yeah, I'd never seen shmups, because shmups were mostly, like, before my generation. There weren't really a lot of them on the N64 and the GameCube, which are the consoles I grew up on. So I never heard of a shmup before, and then, like, once I saw the game and I heard it was, like, super hard, and that was pretty much the only reason I never bought it, because I've always been really bad at games in general. So, like, when people said, oh shit, I didn't even see her knives coming. But people said the game was super hard, I was like, yeah, maybe I should not spend, like, money on it, you know, because I didn't really have a lot of money. So I never bought the game, but I always thought it sounded cool as shit. And then, you know, later on I found out about Treasure, the developers of the game, who, like, are pretty widely regarded as, like, the most underrated video game publishers of all time, or developers of all time. Like, all their games are, like, cult classics, but none of them have ever been super famous, and, like, their name has never really gotten out there beyond, like, really hardcore, like, old-school gaming cliques and stuff like that. So, I've always been curious about the game, because it sounds so interesting. Shit! I am getting fucked right now, and she hasn't even lost a single health. Well, I got totally fucked. Alright, you fucking bitch. So yeah, he was playing that game on his Blue Glow show, and he said that he had, like, a shmup phase when he was in high school, and I was like, man, that's so cool. I never really had a shmup phase, but I remembered I've had a ton of Toho phases, none in which I got good at Toho. That has never been a thing. But I'm a long time, like, secondary fan of Toho, you know? And not in the usual way, because there's two different types of Toho fans, and they're... There's the ones who are really into the games, And those ones tend to be kind of elitist about the other fans, which are the fans who are really into the characters outside the games. Because Toho is like unbelievable levels of fan content, which is really weird for like a game from Japan that is still fairly niche. Like, everyone's heard of Bronies, and everyone's heard of Homestuck, which are similar types of, like, they make a lot of stuff fandoms. But, like, I don't feel like Toho has ever really entered mainstream consciousness in the way that those things have. And the whole time that I was into My Little Pony, I would always tell people, like, you know how crazy it is how much fan art there is of MLP characters? Yeah, Toho is crazier. Like, I used to say that you could take any one Toho character and they had as much fan art as all of MLP. I don't think that's still true. It could be, I don't know. I mean, the level of Toho doujins is, like, unbelievable. But, like, it's just so weird that the fan community for Toho is so insanely active when the franchise is still fairly obscure. Like, it's not something that the average person has heard of, even on the internet, in the way that most people have heard of MLP or Homestuck. I mean, there's never been an Idea Channel episode about Toho, and that kind of says something, because anytime something gets to the level of cultural relevance where, like, the average internet person may have cursory heard of it, Idea Channel will have done a video on it. But there's never been an Idea Channel Toho, and I don't know if he's heard of it. Oh god, what's his name? I don't remember. I'm too drunk to remember. I'm trying to think of it. You know what I'm talking about. The Idea Channel guy. But yeah, it's odd that something could have so much, like so much content made for it in such a niche community. And, the funny thing about Toho is that I've always wanted to talk about it in some capacity. Like, I've been a fan of Toho since, like, 2008. Again, I say secondary, but, like, when people say secondary Toho fans, they usually mean people who aren't a fan of the games. They're just a fan of, like, the fan works, all the doujins and stories, and, like, how all these characters have so much art and stuff created out of them. And, like, while I did get into Toho through the secondary stuff, like, that's not quite what I mean. I don't really know a lot of the fan interpretations of the characters and stuff. Like, I mean, I basically understand how people have interpreted the characters' personalities, you know? I've read enough doujins and seen enough stuff to get, like, what the fan perception of them is. But I wouldn't say that I'm, like, super into that either. So, like, if you're a Toho fan who knows a lot about each character or has, like, a really deep idea of who they are, you know, based on fan content, I'm not that guy. And I'm also not someone who's any good at the games. I've played all the ones up through, like, 13, or I think it was Twin Desires, is that the name of the game? That had 10 Desires. 10 Desires was the last one I played at the time when I was into Toho. So that was quite some time ago. I think there's been 3 or 4 games since then. That was like Toho 13 or 14. But like, yeah, it's the thing is, because I'm like a secondary fan on both fronts, I don't feel like I can represent Toho fans, like, broadly. Like, I feel like if I wrote anything about Toho, it wouldn't be helpful to actual fans of Toho. But, like, at the same time, I really do love the series and care about it. It's just that, like, I've never had things that I can really care about enough to dedicate that level of attention to them. Which was why, when I got into MLP, I got, like, so into it, and why I did all those videos on it, because it was so exciting to have something that, like, was kind of my thing that I could really talk about. In a way that I hadn't before. And this was, like, a long-time frustration of mine as an anime fan, was that, like, as much as I loved anime as a medium, there was never one show or one thing that I was into enough to be, like, an expert on it. Where I knew people who, like, could tell you everything about Toho, who knew every detail. You know, I had friends who were, my friend Ghost Lightning, who was super into Macross. He could have told you anything about any season of Macross. You know, not that he necessarily loved every season of Macross, but he was such a fan of the franchise that he knew everything about it. I knew people who knew everything about Gundam. I love Gundam, but I've never known everything about Gundam, which is why it's harder for me to write about. And, like, so with MLP, that was the first time ever that I knew everything about something. I knew absolutely everything about MLP in the time that I was working on it. You could not have possibly told me something about the show that I would not have known, like about the fan content, about the show itself, about anything. And that was a huge part of like what made it special and what made me want to be a part of it so badly. And now that I'm not into it anymore, I kind of don't have something like that again. Like, I absolutely love Rick and Morty, and I think I know pretty much everything there is to know about Rick and Morty, but I don't think that's, like, a lot. I don't think there's a lot of knowledge to be had about it. There's not really a vibrant fan community or anything. Actually, you know what? I don't even know everything about that, because I haven't played some of the games that they've made, like Pocket Mortys yet, which are pretty popular. I think I'm on the final boss. So yeah, even with that, I don't necessarily know as much as I could, but like, the things I'm a fan of aren't the same. Like with MLP, it was such a huge fandom. There was so much to know that it was like deeply engrossing to be a part of it. And, you know, it gave me that feeling I'd never have of like, I have a favorite show. I have a thing I know everything about. Unfortunately, I don't really like it anymore. You know, I could still tell you most things about the first three seasons, we'll say. Actually, maybe just the first two. Like, even then, I don't know. It's weird. Like, there's a lot of episodes I could tell you the names of if I, like, wrote about them, but, I definitely know a lot less now than I did back then. But, like, I was like, how am I surviving this? I'm, like, doing obscenely well. That all turned on its head. But yeah, like, there's plenty I don't know now, and I don't really care, because I don't think the new seasons are good, and I think the show has retroactively ruined itself. You know, I might as well go into that a little bit here, because there's nowhere else I'm ever going to do it, because I'm never going to make another MLP video, because all I'm going to do if I did that would be to piss off bronies. Because the only people who still care about My Little Pony are bronies. No one outside of the fandom is going to watch the fandom's shit. And the only bronies who are still into the show are the ones who don't want to hear any criticism about it. So there's like, there's no one you'd be appealing to by making a video about why My Little Pony has gone downhill. But it has, because, like, oh shit! I thought I was doing better than that. I think the early episodes of the show have been ruined by the later ones, because there was always this feeling when you were watching MLP, like every character had this epic destiny, which, you know, Lauren Faust had always talked about how that was her intention for the show. Every character had a very clear motivation, a thing they wanted to do, and like a big part of what made the show engaging was thinking that the characters were going to do that one day, that like Rainbow Dash was going to become a Wonderbolt, Rarity was going to get her her place in Canterlot, you know. Twilight was gonna become the Master of Friendship, which she actually did. Like, Twilight was the only one who really achieved her goal, but because of the fact that it had never been established that she wanted to be a princess, it was really weird and jarring the way she did it. Like, it could have been something else, and it probably would have been closer to what was the original vision for the series. But, like, I can't believe I dodged all that. You know, you had this concept of, like, what the characters were going to do, and then what the show did, because every character had an arc that they had to fulfill if they wanted to achieve their dream. Like, you know, Rainbow Dash had to learn how to, like, basically be an adult and grow up and not be, like, so preoccupied with herself, and to worry about other people and to be, like, a team player. Rarity had to learn how to, like... Oh, fuck yeah! Dead parrot, bitch. Whew! Oh my god, did I beat the game? Even on easy mode, this isn't something I've done many times. I think I've done this twice. So, like, the fact that I'm doing this while drunk as shit is really impressing me. Oh my god, I beat it. I have to keep going. I have to go up to normal mode. I don't know if she's the final boss. Because usually you have other bosses on different difficulties. Hanging out with Yuka. Or Yuyuko, rather. Yeah, I did it. Adorable. Let's go up to normal mode. So anyway, as I was saying, Oh, I guess I can't. Can I skip this? I guess I can't skip this, so I'm just gonna watch it. Yeah, like, all the characters had these epic destinies that you thought they were gonna fulfill, and that was a big part of the show, like, that was a big part of the draw going forward, was that, like, each character had such a clear ambition. And what ends up happening in season four, which is that the show went on not necessarily longer than it should have at this point, but that things got out of order, where Twilight became a princess at the end of season three, but the writing didn't seem to accommodate for that until season five. The characters all reached the end of their arcs in season four, but they didn't achieve their epic destinies. So Rainbow Dash, like, basically has the whole arc of getting into the Wonderbolts and then doesn't get in. Rarity has the whole arc of getting her shop and then doesn't get her shop. And, like, and those are the two, like, main ones. The other characters, their ambitions were more nebulous. But, like, with those two, it was like, oh, man. We're never going to see it. Rarity's never going to have her shop. Rainbow Dash is never going to join the Wonderbolts because the show has to go on forever. And so it's over. Like, after season four, all the character arcs were over. And it's, like, it's really sad because season five is, like, just incredibly boring and shitty, and season six, which has just started, I've heard, is like just like an embarrassment. Like, the show is effectively dead at this point, and it's not going anywhere. But, like, it really kills the early episodes too, because so much of the, like, the show is predicated on this idea that these characters are gonna go somewhere and that there's gonna be a payoff. But then you just end up watching them complete their arcs. And, like, you don't realize it at first. Like, when season four was airing, no one figured, oh, that's it. The arc is over. Like, you still had that feeling like, well, okay, Rarity's still going to get her shop. Rainbow Dash is still going to join the Wonderbolts. But then you realize once season five starts, oh, it's never happening. That's not a thing. Like, because the arc is already over, and, like, it sinks in, and you're like, oh my god, they did it, they ruined the show, they actually ruined the show, you know? I'm not someone who often says that about shows. Like, I don't usually get bothered by shows having a bad ending, or maybe, like, a bad second half if the first half was great. Like, I don't think having a bad later part ruins the early part unless it changes the meaning of the early part, and I think that happened with MLP. I think it legitimately, like, the early episodes are worse because you know that the characters will never actually accomplish the goals that you thought they were going to set out to do. So that's why I can't, like, go back and watch it and feel the same way that I did before. That, and also that I just find the animation a lot less appealing than I did back at the time that I was writing about the show and stuff. I read my old stuff about MLP with a certain fascination for the fact that I thought that I had the opinions I had. Like, I understand them, but it's interesting that I felt that way when I don't necessarily feel the same. Ugh, I thought I could escape that, but it was too much. I probably could have if I let go of fire, because apparently fire is slow. I don't know if that's a thing I have turned on, or if that's this character's thing, or what. I also don't know why I have such a huge circle around me. That's really odd. But anyway, I literally don't remember. Oh yeah, now I remember why I was talking about MLP. Because it was so exciting to be in a fandom. To have a thing. To have something that's my thing. You know, and I have, like, stuff that definitely is, like, people associate with me, which is cool. Like, people associate me with being a K-On! Fan, and I really like that. I've only watched K-On! All the way through, I think, twice. Like, yeah, I'm gonna say I've only seen it all the way through twice. I've seen a bunch of episodes three or four times, but, like, you know, it's not nearly that level of depth of knowledge. It's not like a show that I've, like, obsessed over and know everything about. If you tried to give me, like, a K-On! Quiz with, like, really specific questions, I don't know if I'd pass it. God, Tay, why are you so easy? So, with Toho, though, like, with stuff like Toho, where I know that there's fans out there who care so deeply about it, and, like, those are the people who care the most, right? Like, if you made a Toho video, then there's two reactions you're gonna get. Either, what the fuck is Toho, I don't care, or I know everything about Toho, how dare you get it all wrong, you know? So, like, unless I could really make a really interesting point in a way that people who haven't played the game would understand, then there's, like, no broad appeal for that. Because the people who already care about the game aren't gonna enjoy the video because I don't know enough about it. And the people who do, who don't already enjoy the game, like, I have to make them care. And I've had that problem with a lot of things where, like, where I know that I'm not the guy to do it. Like, I feel like there's other people who are more qualified to talk about Toho or to talk about Gundam or other big series like that, which is why it's been so hard for me to talk about them in any kind of depth. And especially with Toho, because, like, I only really know the early characters. Like, I know pretty much the characters up through, or that are in this game. Like, I know all the Embodiment of Scarlet Devil characters really well. They're obviously the most popular. I got into Toho because I was such a big fan of Remelia and Flanders Scarlet, especially Remelia, because, like, I would see so much fan art of her, and all of it was, like, totally fucking rad. And I was like, I don't know who this character is, but she's my waifu. And then, you know, I found out about the games afterwards. I know some of the characters from Imperishable Knight, because that's the game I probably played the most other than this one. I know Yuka Kazami from this game. But again, I don't necessarily know, like, the fandom interpretations of these characters. I don't know what personality Yuka is supposed to have. She's my main in this game, and I don't even know what she's supposed to be like. I don't really know what Konpaku Yomu is supposed to be like either. And she's like an avatar I've used, other than Remelia Scarlet, for years. So yeah, it's really weird. But like, if you were to bring up Toho to me, I'd get excited. Like, it's something that I feel like wrong for not having talked about, because I do care about it and think it's such a cool and interesting topic. But, like, how could I possibly write about it? So, yeah, like, I have all these complex thoughts about Toho. And as a result, I end up not really talking about Toho, because I feel like if I mention it, I'm gonna get sucked into this other, you know, world. And I don't necessarily have time to care about Toho. Like, you know, I don't have time to completely just get into it and, like, learn everything so that I can talk about it. You know, I'm on the level right now of, like, I guess relative internet fame, where literally every time I mention anything, people ask me if I'm gonna do a video about it. Like, I'll tweet, oh, just watch the first episode of this show, it was okay, and then someone will be like, are you gonna do a video? Or if I mark something on my anime list, they'll be like, hey, I saw you were watching this show, can't wait for the video. And I'm like, I just wanted to watch anime. Like, it's not all gonna be videos. But yeah, like, if I mention Toho anywhere, I guarantee you the first question I get is gonna be, are you gonna do a video about Toho? I'm willing to bet at least one of you who's watching this video was already, either have typed or was planning to type the question, are you gonna do a video about Toho, in the comments of this video. I'm willing to bet that it's happened already by the time I'm saying this, at this point. So, yeah, like, the answer is, I don't know. Like, I wish I could do a video about Toho. I wish I was confident enough in my knowledge of Toho to do one, but I don't think I have interesting things to say about Toho. I think other people probably do, who maybe aren't writing videos about it, you know? And I used to go to, like, because at Otakon, there'll always be a Toho panel, and I used to go to them back in the day, but it was just all in jokes. Like, it would always be, like, the hosts, everyone in there is always dressed as a Toho character. It's all dudes who are all cosplaying girls, because if you don't know, Toho has only one male character, and he's not the most popular. So, like, you know, it's mostly people cosplaying, guys cosplaying girl characters. Everyone knows everything. There's always people, like, sitting around playing the games, either during or before the panel, like, on the hardest difficulty, doing everything, you know. I distinctly remember sitting outside a Toho panel one year, just watching a guy beat Cyrano's Great Fairy Wars on, like, the hardest difficulty, which is, like, one of the harder Toho games, too, I believe. So, like, it's shorter, but, like, the final bosses are pretty fucking hard. Not that any Toho game is easy, despite what the fans might tell you about some of them. But, like, yeah. Like, and they'd just be telling jokes that I just don't get. I'm like, I love this franchise, but I don't understand what the fuck you guys are talking about, you know? So, like, there's a level that you'd have to be on that I feel like I won't get to ever, you know? And so I just end up never talking about Toho. And that makes me upset because I'm such a big fan of it in spite of not being that kind of fan. I don't know. Fandom for me is like a weird thing. I consider myself a very obsessive person, but I guess the way I obsess with things is different. Like, I don't obsess over the creator's vision so much as like my like what I get out of it, you know. Like, as an anime fan, I probably spend more time making lists of my favorite anime than I do actually watching anime. Like, for me, it's a very selfish hobby. It's like, I mean, there's a reason I call myself a gonzo journalist and why I write from this perspective that's very subjective and like very focused on myself, is that like the way I engage with anime has less to do with the work and more to do with its relationship to me and like what the work tells me about myself. Like, I'd say that's what I find most interesting about art, is like what I can learn about me from the art more so than like what I can learn about the other person, if that makes sense. So like, I don't know, it's odd for me. Like, something could be my favorite thing ever, but I can be less into it than someone who doesn't care that much about it. Like, I know when people like don't understand my drop list, like when people are like, how can you drop so much anime? And it's like, I feel like the stuff that they would give a 6 out of 10, they might be more interested in than the stuff that I would give an 8 out of 10, you know? Like some people, for some people, their favorite show is a show they've watched 50 fucking times, and like, they know every line of dialogue from it. It was interesting for me because when I was first like into anime in like 07, 08, like when, or not first into anime, but first like into anime blogging, I didn't used to rewatch stuff at all. The way I saw it, like, there was too much stuff out there. You know, I'd never have time to rewatch stuff. It was all about moving forward and watching the next thing. And like, then my friend Ghost Lightning, he had like this co-blogger named Mecha Fetish, and he had written this post about like the joys of rewatching stuff, because he was you just rewatch stuff all the time. And this dude had rewatched like the last episode of Gurren Lagann something like 40 times. And, you know, was talking about how cool it was to rewatch all this different shit. And, like, it was, the way he wrote about it just made it sound really inspiring and cool. And, like, made me think that rewatching was a cool thing to do. And then I did rewatch some stuff and realized how awesome it was. Because, like, most of the stuff I love, I appreciated even more the second time through. So then I developed this mindset that I currently have that, like, for me, a show really only like starts on the second viewing. Like, it starts on the viewing where I really care and know things about it, and like I can look at it even deeper than I was the first time. But the first time it's more like just immediate, like, yeah, this is rad. And the second time is where you're like, oh man, I get why this is rad, and like I really feel all these things, and I know what's gonna happen later, and like it makes the early stuff even more interesting sometimes, you know? So like, yeah, it's like the rewatch is the coolest part of the show for me now. But, like, I've never gotten to that level of rewatching something fucking 30 times, you know? It's like, I'm trying to think of what thing I've rewatched the most times. And it's, like, maybe the first half of the first episode of Garzy's Wing. Like, I've watched the first half of episode one of that. Like, probably, no, yeah, FLCL, like, I've probably seen FLCL about 10 or 11 times, so that's probably the thing I've seen the most, but that's only 6 episodes, so it's pretty easy to rewatch. But yeah, like, I don't know, I feel like there's probably people who, like Ghost Lightning, he would rewatch a lot of stuff too, and like, he would rewatch, you know, great episodes of any show he watched. If the episode was really good, he'd watch it a bunch of times, and like, I don't have that for anything. You know, there's probably shows that we both gave an 8 out of 10, but he watched, like, way more times than I did and was, like, way more invested in it and remembers it better and has more to say about it than I do. So, yeah. It's a hang-up of mine, man. I've always, like, had trouble with that. And that's why, like, I don't think my... I think one of the, like, things that I've been the most angsty about with my anime reviews since I started doing them is the fact that I don't feel like I've ever really gotten to the heart of, like, my own fandom. Maybe more so now because, like, the way I engage with anime these days is mostly to write videos about it. So, like... I've gotten to that point where there's not as much of me just, like, watching anime for the sake of it or engaging with the, okay, I died, and I think I had a continue, but I didn't use it because I didn't, understand the Japanese text. Let's try normal mode again. Let's try a different character. Let's play as Marisa. I have no idea how Marisa plays or if she's any... Okay, she... has this going on. Oh, the pink must be the radius for my super move. I didn't even, like, use a super once this whole game. I forgot it was a mechanic. But that looks like the radius of a Master Spark, so that might be what it is. But anyway, yeah, like... Oh, shit. These days, I mostly watch stuff, like, knowing I'm gonna review it or knowing that I'm gonna make videos about it. So I end up watching more things that are, like, directly relevant to what I'm going to talk about. But, like, I have days where I might be, like, really just watching anime openings all day. And I have, like, no real way to write about them in a, like, that would justify, like, I don't think anyone understands how important anime openings are to me. Because, like, when I want to feel that I really care about anime, I'll often just watch a bunch of openings. And, like, that gets me super hype about shows. And there's no way that I know how to write about them that would communicate that, you know. Mother's Basement does those, like, deep, analytical videos about OPs, which are always, like, really eye-opening to me because I never have seen any of the shit he talks about. But, like, I just like the music and the, like, aesthetic of them, usually. You know, the ones I like aren't usually the super deep, symbolic ones. They're usually the ones that are just, like, cool images and sounds, but, like... they kind of cut to the core of, like, what is so cool about anime to me. So, OPs are, like, kind of a big deal. I have no way of celebrating them. So when I get into those big OP kicks, I'm just like, man, this is so integral to my appreciation of anime, and I don't know how to, like, make my audience celebrate it with me. Or a game like Toho, you know? When I get really into Toho, it's like one of the most otaku feelings I can have and like something I can get deeply passionate about, but because I'm not on like the level where I could talk about it in depth, I don't feel like I can communicate it to people. There's a number of things like that. So or Sakuga is another big one where like I don't know, I find talking about Sakuga kind of like I find it interesting to read about Sakuga, like, people who know a lot about it. For those who don't know what that is, Sakuga is, like, you know, animation. Like, people use the term mostly to refer to really nice animation. Like, anytime something looks really amazing. And, like, I'll watch a ton of Sakuga AMVs and shit and, like, learn about animators and stuff. But, like, I like knowing that stuff, but I don't find it particularly interesting to be like, look at this guy, he did this! Like, that's not a kind of writing that I'm that into. I can get into it when it's like my Cowboy Bebop video, where it's like I'm tracing the whole lineage of a show or something like that. But like, I don't know, the way guys like, Canepa Show do it is not at all interesting to me. Where like, he seems to find the most interesting way to write about anime to be to like, name all the people who worked on the anime. And I just think that's super fucking boring. And doesn't really communicate what's good about those people. And I've actually come to, funnily enough, like, I used to, like, really admire Sakuga people for knowing so much. Like, I was kind of jealous of their knowledge because I still am, like, kind of a noob when it comes to Sakuga stuff. Because I probably know animators a lot more than, like, the average person, but not as much as a huge Sakuga nerd who can, like, tell who animated something just by looking at it. But, through starting to follow those people more on Twitter and stuff, I realized that a lot of them are just into any nice looking animation. And I'm like way picky about it, you know, like, I need it to be well directed, I need to care, like, I need the context and stuff like that, like, just, like, stuff being fluid doesn't impress me, it has to be well choreographed and, like, well timed and everything, and, like, I'll be following these Sakuga people who will post, like, scenes from fucking Asterisk War and be like, oh yeah, this animator worked on Asterisk War and did some pretty cool scenes, and I'm like, the scenes are, like, well animated in the sense of things are moving a lot, but they're not good, they're not engaging scenes, they're not memorable, the color design looks like shit, the 3D backgrounds look like shit, you know? Like, Canepa just had this video on Pokemon X and Y, and, like, he's, like, really celebrating the 3D camera work, and I'm like, it's an interesting technique, and it's cool, it could be used well, but the way it looks in the show, all the 2D animation looks superimposed onto the 3D animation, and it just kind of looks like shit. Like, it's a cool technique, but it's not being used well, and I feel like, he's impressed with the mere fact that things are moving in his anime as opposed to sitting still, and not, like, whether the movement looks good. I mean, that could be a mischaracterization. I just feel like all the Sakuga people I follow don't have taste. They just like things to move more so than for them to move in, like, an engaging way. So, yeah, I don't know. I'm picky about everything, so that's hardly surprising. But, like, oh, another one, porn. I've never been able to talk about porn because I don't understand how to make talking about what porn I like interesting without it just being creepy. Like, I think that most people who consider themselves anime fans engage in anime porn. And, like, I don't know, there's a lot of people who make it out like it's, you know, whoa, you're talking about porn, but, like, I feel like it's super normal, because all my offline friends are into anime porn. Like, I literally don't know anybody who's embarrassed about that stuff. And maybe it's just that because it's normal within my group of friends, it seems more normal to me. Like, me and my friends can talk about porn openly, and it's not a big deal. Maybe for other people it is. You know, like, I can talk to the people I know about, like, even, like, weird shit, like kinks, and it's just nothing. It doesn't mean anything. We can be like, yeah, I watched this, look at this cool porn about this, like, lolly getting raped by demons, and we'll be like, yeah, that sounds great, and, you know, I feel like there's a lot of people whose reaction is the opposite. And it's hard to, like, with a medium like YouTube, it's hard to, like, mediate that. Like, you can't. It's impossible for me to make something and then only release it to the people who would be interested in it. It's going to be seen by everybody, and it's going to color some people's perception or just, you know, give them a weird idea about me or my content or something, you know. I think that if I did find the words to talk about porn in an interesting way, there'd be people who'd really appreciate it, but I don't know how much the cost-benefit is, you know. I don't know how many people will love it in comparison to how many people will hate it or think it's really weird. And also, how much can I really say about it? Like, I've wanted to talk about, like, what makes anime girls hot. Like, I think that's a fascinating topic, but I really don't know how to describe why anime girls are hot. Like, I have a lot of theories and stuff, and it's really mostly about line art to me. Like, I have very specific tastes in what I find to be attractive in anime characters, and I think they align with stuff that gets really popular. Like, I think if you saw, like, if I pointed to a picture and said, this is a super hot anime girl, you'd be like, yeah, I agree. You know, my tastes aren't really that weird, it's more that they're super, specific and picky. Like, I think most people are into more stuff than I am because more people are willing to accept more stuff than I am. Whereas I want, like, all the art to be beautiful and perfect. But, like, trying to actually describe what about line art could make a character attractive is, like, I'm not an artist, and it's hard. So, yeah, like, I don't know. It's just something I haven't found the words to talk about yet, but it's such a huge part of how I engage with anime that, like, it feels weird to have not talked about it, you know? Whereas a lot of people would be like, it's weird that you are talking about it. For me, it's super weird that I've never talked about it, that I've never really addressed the issue, because it's more important to me than a lot of the videos I've made, you know? If I make, like, a one-off review of a show like Erased that I'll never think about again, you know, I mean, I've thought about it more than I expected to just because of the fact that my video was so fucking controversial that nobody shuts up about it, but, like, you know, that's just, like, a random thing that's just like, eh, whatever, this is about anime, let's write about it, you know? Even some of the stuff I write positively about might be, like, totally inconsequential to my overall feelings on anime. But stuff like, you know, what makes anime girls hot, or what makes Toho cool, or what makes Gundam cool, is so much more important, and I haven't covered it. And that's all why, like, you know, if anybody ever, like, wonders if I'm gonna run out of content on my channel, it can't possibly happen, because I haven't even covered a lot of the most important shit. Like, you know, I've covered a lot of individually my favorite shows, and I've, you know, I've kind of run out of, like, shows that I currently consider a 10 out of 10 to talk about, which is why I ran into this, like, rut of talking about shows I don't like, because, like, I'd covered most of the really great stuff. But there's some shows I haven't. I still haven't written a big thing about Shirobako. I still haven't written you know, I could do a whole book about Hunter x Hunter if I wanted to. A lot of the shows I covered, I've only done a little bit about, so, like, I could do a lot more about them. You know, the world really wants me to do more Ava videos, and I might do that one day. But, like, the stuff I have, like, I think there's certain things that people know they want me to do. People know they want me to talk about Ava. People know they want me to talk about, like, certain shows or certain topics. There's a lot of stuff I want to talk about people don't even know that I want to talk about. People don't know I want to talk about Toho or fucking Gundam. Gundam's, like, the biggest one. Like, I have so, like, it's been, like, my number one ambition forever to one day talk about Gundam, because I feel like there's so much to say about it, and it's so important, and it's still so good. Like, Gundam is currently the best it's ever been. There's been, like, all these amazing OVAs coming out. There's been Gundam Unicorn. There's been Gundam The Origin. Gundam Thunderbolt, which are, like, some of the best OVAs that the series has ever had. It just had Iron-Blooded Orphans, which all the Gundam fans I know who have watched it have said it's one of the best shows in the franchise. It's definitely, like, one of the best alternate century shows. Gundam Build Fighters, which a lot of, like, big fans of the franchise have been super into, because they said it's finally a kid's Gundam done right, whereas most of the alternate century stuff was, like, Gundam for teenagers done really badly. So, like, yeah, like, Gundam's in a golden age of Gundam. Like, it's the best that Gundam has ever been, and yet the only people who give a single fuck are people who already are into Gundam. You know, and it's so integral to anime history, and so few people seem to care about it anymore. Like, you know, it used to be that at least the alternate century shows got watched, because, like, you didn't have to know anything, and they were simply directed. So, like, you know, Gundam Wing was popular in its time, Gundam Seed was popular in its time, Gundam 00 was popular in its time. But Iron-Blooded Orphans, nobody even gives a fuck anymore. Like, the alternate century is, well, like, the whole point of alternate century is that it's more broadly appealing, that you don't have to know the whole Gundam narrative to get into it. But at this point, the word Gundam doesn't carry weight for casual anime fans anymore. They're just like, whatever, it's old robot shows, you know? They don't give a fuck. Giant robots are a dead genre outside of Gundam. Gundam's the only fucking giant robot franchise still going, because people are just not interested in the concept anymore, as weird as that is, except for people who are super into it, who are, you know, enough of a minority that they can't buy enough Gundams to make them come out. Or just Sunrise is making such a killing on it that nobody else can compete anymore. You know, I mean, Bones every once in a while tries to do a robot show, but like the last one they did was Captain Earth, and nobody seemed to be that into it. So, yeah, I think robots are pretty much relegated to Sunrise for the time being. But and Sunrise is only interested in doing Gundam because it's obviously gonna make the most money. I think the last non-Gundam one they did might have been like Valvik. Actually, you know what? It was Cross Ange. I don't know. Cross Range, I think, was mechas. It might have been like planes, more like. All right, let's continue. I don't know if that's how you pronounce that show's title, by the way. It's a weird title. So yeah, but it's been like a long time dream of mine because back in 2011 when I visited my friend Ghost Lightning in the Philippines, like he was like discussing Gundam with me because he would tell me like the whole history of shows like Gundam and Macross, and he was telling me everything about Gundam, and you know, I've seen a considerable amount of it myself, and I really think that Char, the main villain of the original Gundam, or like the rival character rather, is like the ultimate anime character. He is the most perfect anime character, and I've talked about this in my in our Star Fox Let's Play on this channel that I did with Brandon Tolentino, but like I want to write about Char so badly because I think he's like the most fascinating anime character and the most anime character, and I just like I feel like I'll never be fulfilled as a person until I do that. But I don't feel like I can do it until I watch all of Gundam. Like, I really want to watch every single installment of the franchise. And the only way I'm ever going to have time to do that is if I can somehow, you know, dedicate a month or two of my life to watching all of Gundam. And the hardest thing about that is that no one cares about it anymore. Like, if Gundam Iron-Blooded Orphans or Thunderbolt or something was, like, pulling huge numbers on my anime list, or, like, you know, lots of anime YouTube people were requesting it from me or something, like, my fans were talking about it, then I'd be like, fuck yeah, I'm gonna watch all of Gundam, I'm gonna talk about all of Gundam, like, this is gonna be my thing, you know? I'm just gonna be a Gundam guy for a while. But no one cares. If I watch the original Gundam series and write about it, it's not gonna get any views. You know, and like, I think, a lot of people think, if I talk about something like views like that, people will say, because I've been accused a lot lately of doing clickbait videos, and I am doing clickbait videos, but not for the reason that I think people assume. Like, I'm not doing it to make money per se. Like, I mean, the money is obviously a huge benefit and I love having money, but like, I feel like I want my videos to connect with a lot of people, and the best way to do that is to write about something that a lot of people care about. Where like, if I write a video that you know, only a few hundred people actually give a fuck about, then that's nice, and I love that I can connect with those people, but, like, I could just as easily be writing a video that 1,000 people will care about, you know? Or 100,000 people will care about. And, like, that's a hell of a lot more tempting. So, you know, I don't think that, like, I'm not gonna just write videos about stuff just because people care about it, per se. But... oh, well, I guess I am, because that's basically what I did last season. Like, there's no reason to write about Erased other than the fact that it was popular. I refuse to write about Grimgar because it's just going to be the same shit. I'm just going to be mad, and people aren't going to like it. But, you know, it was a... like, the reason I wrote about all this, the winter season shows, is that it was a chance to connect with my audience, because I was writing about shows people were watching. Like, shows that most anime fans who watch current anime had seen those shows, you know? And mind you, in my best interest, I'd write about One Punch Man, but I won't write about something if I don't have enough to say about it. That's why when people call me a sellout, I always have to kind of be like, dude, if I was really a sellout, I would just write about, like, you know, One Punch Man and Attack on Titan, which Attack on Titan's not really relevant anymore, but like that was, that used to be my go-to whenever someone called me a sellout. I was like, if I was a sellout, I'd write about Attack on Titan. I have nothing to say about Attack on Titan. I'm not interested in it. I just completely don't care about it, but like it would have been instant views if I wrote anything about it. Or when people say I'm being controversial or negative for the sake of views, like people don't understand. That is the opposite of how, like, writing something negative about something will get you views, but I think writing something positive about something that a lot of people love will get you a lot more views, because it's way more shareable. Because, think about it, let's say that Sword Art Online is the most popular anime, right, of the last 5 years. Because it's so popular, there's a huge contingent of people who hate it. There's a huge contingent of people who think it's the worst thing ever. And all those people are going to share a negative video about Sword Art Online amongst their friends because they want to shit on it and feel superior to Sword Art Online fans. But imagine if you wrote something really strong in defense of Sword Art Online. Because for the show to be the most popular show, that means that there's a fuckload of people who really love the show. And so, if I wrote something that was just glowing praise for it, but while being intellectual, like something that people, you know, really connected with, but defended the show for them, that would get huge because they'd share it to everyone. Because anytime they, because they, you know, those shows have a lot of haters, and the people who love the show are going to get into arguments with those haters. So how are they going to win arguments? They're going to post your video. How are they gonna, you know, they're gonna cite your video. How are they gonna get their friends into the show? They're gonna share your video on Facebook. So, like, I think talking positively about a popular show will get you way more views than talking negatively about a popular show. Both are great for views, but, like, you know, if I wrote a video called Erased is the Best Anime Ever, and, like, all I did was focus on the positives and make it look like it was the best anime ever, that video would have fucking just gone apeshit viral, you know? Like, people would have wanted it to justify their feelings. They would have used it to win arguments. It would have gotten huge on our anime, who now absolutely hate my guts. My video, every time someone tries to post one of my videos on our anime, even when it's, like, completely innocuous, like my video about, what is the appeal of anime, got like 50% downvotes just because people hate me on there, just because of that Erased video, you know? Damaging my reputation like that does not help my videos to get more popular. Certainly doesn't help me to get more valuable comment sections, and as somebody who likes reading comments, having shitty comment sections is not always necessarily worth the so-called money. So yeah, like, I don't really benefit from writing a bunch of negative reviews. It's just that, like, I was interested in writing about stuff that people cared about for once. You know, whether my impression was negative or positive, whether it would necessarily be helpful to those people or not, I just wanted to write about stuff that would be relatable to my audience. God, this boss is fucking hard. Holy shit. Like, I had no idea how to get out of that at that point. Man, I don't remember why I'm talking about this. The point is, I wanna write about Toho, but I don't have the words to do it. It'd be a beautiful time. It's just been a long-standing frustration. It's also a frustration that I'm not good at Toho. Like, I don't know. I'm really jealous of everyone who's obsessed with anything. Like anything individual. Like, I'm obviously super obsessed with anime, I'm obsessed with my career, I'm obsessed with myself, I'm obsessed with making videos, I'm obsessed with listing above all else. People know that I'm a huge list guy, but like, when I see people who have like one video game that they are so proficient at that they know everything, you know, if you look at fucking Lobos Jr. playing Dark Souls, like the stuff that he does, or fucking Pan and Koic playing Super Mario 64, fucking going through parallel universes and all that shit. And I'm just like, why don't I love anything that much? Why am I not, you know, that deeply involved in any one thing? Why can't I... If you ever watch someone play like a final boss of Toho on the highest difficulty, you will seriously question what that person has been doing with their month, you know. Because that's about how long I think it would take to practice it. And I just have nothing like that. Even MLP, like, while I knew everything about the show, I didn't watch it a whole ton of times. Like, I probably watched... I mean, there's episodes, even in the ones that I talked about, that I only watched once, you know, and most of them I only saw twice. I'd say there's probably only, like, 5 or 6 episodes that I watched 4 times or more. Like, my favorite ones, I probably watched that much times. But, like, there's no episode that I watched, like, obsessively. It's just that I consumed so much fan content and, like, information about the episodes that I would often know, like... I'd know them better than I would just by, like, watching them once. But, like, you know, there's plenty I couldn't tell you that most fans of the show who are, like, obsessive probably know. Ugh. But I did know the fan content pretty fucking deeply, because I had, you know, watched, like, entire archives of fan content. Oh, I think I've almost got her. Bomb that bitch. I don't want to deal with this shit. Finally remembered I had bombs. Some of my viewers are probably like screaming, why the fuck aren't you using bombs like this whole playthrough? Anybody who really knows Toho. Oh shit, I can't bomb again. Oh god, I'm fucked. I'm fucked. I am fucked. Oh, I got a bomb. Sweet. Sweet, sweet, sweet. Please die. Please die, bitch. Please die, bitch. Bitch, bitch, bitch. Please die, bitch. Please die, bitch. Please die, bitch. Yes! Yes! You fucker! Oh, God. This is the final. Oh, no. I thought I was on the final for some reason. Oh, I'm gonna finish off this wine. Oh, Jesus Christ. There was another topic I wanted to talk about, but I don't really remember what it is. Like, I know there was something else that came to mind towards the end of Jesse's Let's Play. His Blue Glow episode. But I don't remember what the fuck it was for the life of me. Ah, shit! I should not have gotten hit by something that easy. God damn it! Music in these games is fucking incredible, of course. You know, random Toho fact. This puts into perspective... Oh my god, how did I not see that fucking coming? This puts into perspective how, like, ridiculous the fan content for these games is. Because, like... The Toho games have really great music. That's one of the things they're best known for, is, like, they're really, intense fucking soundtracks. And, like, you know, fans would make their own versions of these songs. They either, like, remix them or play them on different instruments and stuff, as they tend to do, you know. I'd say Toho was, like, doing it before it was cool. Like, nowadays, you got guys like Smooth Groove with, like, 2 million subscribers who, like, everybody knows about. Doing, you know, covers of video game music, but, like, Toho had a vibrant community of video game music, like, before YouTube had that as, like, a big thing that was going on. In 2008, there was a torrent going around of all the Toho fan music, like, all of the, just everything anybody had made, and that torrent was 160 gigs. 160 gigabytes of just fan remixes of Toho songs. That's fucking insanity. That's like probably thousands of albums. At least hundreds. I don't know how many albums it is. Oh god. But it's a fuck ton. And that's complete craziness. That's why, like, again, like, when I was in the Brony fandom, I kept trying to tell people, like, because people, you know, thought that they were, like, unique with how much fan content they have. And I'm like, guys, you really don't understand. Like, if you saw Toho, you'd really be like, oh my god, like, it's crazy. But, and that was 2008, so imagine what it must be now. Because what made that number so special in 2008 was that back then, 160 gigs was the typical size of a hard drive. Like, that was, if you had a modern computer in 2008, your hard drive was probably 160 gigs. I'm assuming I'm getting my years right. But, like, I think that's what my hard drive was, you know. I won't say modern, because I mean, like, casual guy with a computer. Not, like, tech guy who probably, you know, would have, like, 300 or some shit. But, like, or even a terabyte, like, external. I'm sure those were around, but, yeah, like, it was nuts how much music there was, and I'm sure there's fucking 10 times as much now, so the level is just pure insanity. You know, there's, like, bands that are, like, famous for Toho covers and shit. I'm trying to remember the name of that metal band. There was, like a Toho metal cover band that was, pretty big. I have one of their albums. Well, I had it before my computer died and I lost everything, but, yeah, man, and I know a lot of these songs, and I used to be, that's another thing, is Nico Nico Doga. Like, I used to be, in, like, 2009, I had a kick of getting really into Nico Nico Doga, which is, like, the Japanese YouTube equivalent, and, I knew, like, a lot of the memes, because there's this thing called the Ryusegun, which is, like, this 14-minute, musical mashup of every fucking Nico Nico Doga meme of the time. Like, all the songs that were popular at the time, all the, like, weird shit that would always show up in videos. It's just this fucking epic meme song, and I can sing it. Like, I listened to it so many times and would read the lyrics, and, like, I was super into that song. That's another one that, like, if I want to, like, remind myself of, like, how big of an otaku I am, I can just, like, listen to the Ryusegun and sing along, and, like, it's the best time ever. And I have no way of talking about that, like, especially because it's not relevant anymore, because, like, these were Nico Nico Doga memes of 2008 or 2009, so, like, you know, unless you were there at the time, the Ryusegun means nothing to you. It really is not something that, like, holds up or makes sense anymore. You really had to know it back then to give a single fuck about it. So it's kind of like a relic. It's really a moment in time. But, like, at the same time, that is really, like, I love hearing about stuff like that. Like, I love hearing about, like, you know, historical objects of like a medium. Those kind of things don't tend to get a lot of views. And I've done videos like that before, and I feel like the response is usually mostly confusion. You know, like, when I did my, my Cowboy Bebop, like, what's the word? Diaspora video. Like, about all the people who worked on Cowboy Bebop. And it was like, that video got, it didn't get very great views. Like, it definitely underperformed compared to what we had expected it to. Because I paid Victor to edit that, and, like, he really put a lot of work into it, and then was, like, really disappointed with how little views it got. But, like, you know, I expected it to be, like, a big deal because it was so interesting to me. But, like, the kind of stuff I was talking about, I don't think most people give a fuck about. And, yeah, some people thought it was, like, the most interesting thing ever, but, like, you know, the level of work it takes to talk about something like that is just not equivalent to the, like, amount of, like, giving a shit that the audience will do about it. So, as entertaining as it would be for me to write something like, yeah, look at this fucking anime song collection from 2009 and how cool it was. Like, people would be like, who the fuck cares? This is totally meaningless today. Like, it offers me nothing. If you weren't there in 2009, then, it's kind of hard to give a shit about. But I don't know, I can still listen to it, and it can still totally rekindle my otaku spirit, you know? People have this, like, impression sometimes that I'm, like, like not like I'm super critical of anime and its culture, or like I'm not that into it or something. They don't understand, because that's what gets to me the most. Like when I write, yeah, fuck yeah, whoo. When I write somewhat negative videos, like the biggest thing I worry about is when I get comments that are like, you seem like you just don't like anime. And I'm like, dude, I like anime more than anyone in the world. You just don't understand. I like it so much that I can't take it when it's not perfect, you know? But, I don't know. I think I'm pretty fucking deep. All right, well, I think I used like two continues, but I did in fact beat normal mode of Phantasmagoria Flower View, which I'm maybe done before? I don't know. I think I've usually run out of continues and not been able to do it. So doing that while this drunk is pretty impressive for myself. Anyways, thanks everybody for watching. I just realized this video is an hour long and not the 40 hour and 10 minutes long and not the 40 minutes I thought it was. So I hope you enjoyed it. I hope my like incoherent rambling wasn't too repetitive, because I feel like I like reiterated the same thing for an hour. But this might be what the channel becomes when Victor leaves, so get used to it.